Hello and welcome to the Sensibly Speaking Podcast. This is Chris Shelton and I am the critical thinker at large. This week represents a brand new take on the Sensibly Speaking Podcast. We will be going in a new format, new direction here. So same purpose, of course, but a new format, new direction. So please welcome the Sensibly Speaking Podcast 2.0. Guys, sorry, guys,
yeah.
Hello, this is supposed to be, okay, I'm sorry, you hire these minions and you expect them, okay, wait. You know, we're recording, okay, are we ready now? We're ready, okay. All right, so, without further ado, I present the Sensibly Speaking Podcast 2.0. All right. Good. So, you might notice that I'm here by myself. That is by design. Ruth and I are still best friends. There has been no falling out, no hard feelings, no weirdness, no arguments, nothing like that. She has other projects that she is going to be doing, and I am going to be carrying on with this project because this has always been my brainchild, so to speak, and she was a great co-host with me. But the format and the what we were doing and the direction we were going in was, I didn't think, was really working the way that I wanted it to, and so I'm gonna be moving forward in a new direction now. And actually, I'm going to explain a lot of that during the course of this show. So stick with me, and you'll understand what I'm talking about. I made some show notes here because there's a lot to talk about here this week. I want to try to maybe dig myself out a little bit of a couple holes I think we might have dug ourselves into about and talking about certain things, and specifically, politics and social issues. Now, these are very, very, difficult issues to get into, especially when it comes to being a critical thinker or, trying to be fact-based. It's rough getting into politics and talking about politics and getting into social issues. And, you know, I've been looking at a lot of YouTube, a lot of social media, and seeing that the fact of the matter is that, as far as I can tell, you're really only popular when it comes to politics and social issues if you're contentious and a jerk, really. And the thing is, I'm not a jerk. And I don't want to, I don't think that entering into that foray was really, into that forum was really a very good, idea, okay? We wanted to talk about news, we wanted to talk about current events and that sort of thing, but one of the problems with that is that not all the, with news stories, especially ones that have just happened, not all the facts are there, and it's actually impossible to make rational, informed decisions and conclusions about things when they're literally still happening. So that, you can voice opinions, but you have to realize that that's really all you're doing is voicing opinions. And so if you start talking about the facts of things, you can end up in a lot of trouble. And when it comes to politics and social issues, then you are entering into the area of straight up opinions. And there's just really nothing but opinions. And so that's kind of where it goes. And, some people on YouTube make their living by appealing to people of the same mindset as them and calling anyone else names if they don't agree with them. And I can't do that. And I don't, or maybe I could do that, but I don't want to do that. That's not how I want to run my channel. That's not how I want to present information to you guys. That's not what I think is particularly, it might be entertaining, but I don't particularly think it's informative, and I don't think that it's critical thinking. I don't think it's a good example of skepticism, to say, well, I've concluded this, and if you don't agree with me, go kill yourself. right? Or, well, this guy's just an idiot because, you know, he clearly doesn't see, you know, the plain truth of this is, you know, XYZ. And he's just a moron for not seeing this. What kind of moron wouldn't see this? That's not really an approach I want to take, although it seems to be a popular one. Well, all right. Maybe it won't be so popular then, but that's just not in my nature. Now, I also want to say that I think it's hilarious that when I put myself out as a critical thinker, that people agree with me that I'm a great critical thinker so long as I agree what they were already thinking. And I get people commenting that they're not going to listen to my channel anymore because I said things that they don't agree with, and therefore I'm not a critical thinker. Well, you're obviously not a critical thinker. And, you know, really all that tells me is that I'm really not doing my job of talking about critical thinking very well if I can't, you know, get across the idea that critical thinking involves listening to all sides. It involves getting all the facts, you know. I wish there was I wish we could somehow popularize a hashtag facts matter, you know, because they do. Facts matter. All the facts matter. And I don't pretend to have all the facts. I don't pretend to know everything. But I do, I'm not pretending when I say that I am trying to get all the facts, that I want to operate on all the facts, and when new facts are presented or new information is presented, that I will seriously consider it. I will look at it. I will really pay attention. And unfortunately, not everybody can say that, you know? And I think that it's important to realize that the only way we can grow and expand and really live a full life, I think, is to accept and look at other people's points of view, other opinions, and other facts, right? Opinions are one thing, facts are another. You don't get to, you know, you choose your friends, you choose your opinions, you don't get to choose your facts. And I think that a lot of our opinions should be based on facts, but they should be based on all the facts. And sometimes that's hard to get at. It's very, very true. Sometimes it's very hard. But if we work in that direction, then I think we're working in the right direction. And I think when we, you know, take a position based on fact A and B and say, well, this is how it is, we lose a little bit when there's clearly fact C and D and E out there that are just being ignored or, you know, or negated or whatever. Okay. You know, politics and issues like feminism or racism, things like that, these are almost impervious to critical thinking. One, because they're very multi-layered issues. There's a lot going on. There's a lot in terms of causes and effects and history and reasons why things are happening. It never comes down to one reason, ever. Not with issues like those. And also, you know, the sad truth is that for a lot of people, and I don't know, maybe sometimes I get pretty cynical and start thinking most people, but I don't know about this. But for a lot of people, facts don't matter, right? That's not, you know, or rather, to be more precise, facts do matter, but only their facts matter. And the facts that stand in their way of their, you know, worldview, those don't matter so much. Those aren't important, right? People live in echo chambers and they get pretty comfortable in them. And they only want to, you know, surround themselves with things that they agree with. And it reinforces their worldview and it keeps them focused on a particular way of looking or thinking or acting. And so they don't grow and they don't expand. And I think that's a shame, you know. I've certainly made mistakes with this, you know, all the time. And I realized that for me on this podcast, politics and social issues are not actually areas of expertise, you know, that I have. I'm not a political science junkie. I've not studied it. I've not, you know, not at length like in school, university. I'm not a sociologist and I can't pretend to be. Right? So these are not areas that I am on solid ground when I'm talking about them. And so I have bounced, you know, back and forth to a degree on these topics because of that, because I don't have all the facts or the facts, or we've been speaking about things on this podcast where it's been impossible to get all the facts. And when you don't have all of them, you are definitely going to make incorrect conclusions and voice things that maybe later on you look back at and you go, well, you know, that wasn't so smart. You know, politics and social issues, though, are not fields of expertise for most people. You know, but everybody's got their opinions. And I guess in the end they should, you know. But most of those opinions have very little to do with what's actually going on in the real world. And I'll give you some examples of that later on here in the show. I've talked about confirmation bias before on my channel. This is a really important thing. This is this echo chamber I was talking about, where people, you know, have a worldview or have a, not worldview, or an opinion or an idea about a particular area of endeavor or a subject or something. And then when they, you know, if they're not critical thinkers, then what they do is they'll form this opinion or this idea, and then they'll just hold on to that. And anything that disturbs that doesn't get in. You know, they won't let it in. They'll either ignore it, or they literally, the psychology of this is fascinating, because sometimes people just don't even see other things that don't agree with their confirmation bias, right? And of course, you know, I can be called on this 7 days a week on, you know, my experience in Scientology and how for many, many years I had the blinders on, head down, head in the sand. You know, if it doesn't agree with what L. Ron Hubbard says, then it can't be true. And that was something that ruled my life for a very long time. And so I guess I feel like when it comes to things like that, I speak with authority only because having recognized that with you know, how powerful that could be, and seeing how wrong that can be, and how what wrong conclusions and wrong ways of reasoning and what a waste of time that can be, I guess that's why I'm an advocate against it. And I think I think when it comes to that topic, you know, I kind of know what I'm talking about. Now, excuse me, 2 weeks ago, we brought up Black Lives Matter. And it's very true that in the heat of the moment, we aired that podcast within a day of two shootings, you know, in Baton Rouge and in Minnesota. I mean, the data was fresh, and we were emotionally impacted by it. We were emotionally impacted by earlier incidences of violence against Black people by police. This has been in the media for a very long time. It's been being talked about for a few years now, and a picture has been painted that is a very inaccurate. Well, it has inaccuracies in it. And I'm gonna elucidate some of those. But I rushed to judgment in talking about the actions of the police involved in the shootings of Anton Sterling and Philando Castillo. Now, it was, you know, as I've said, it was impossible to know all the facts. And Ruth and I took up a position that, based on the evidence that we did have, which were mainly the videos and the scant police reports in the media, that the police acted incorrectly. Now, as of right this second, I still believe that's true in those two cases. But I'll keep my opinions about that to myself at this point until all the facts are in. So, in backing away from this stuff, I want to say that some things about the facts and about what's right and what's wrong, right? Mainly, I want to sort of set the record straight on a few things that I've been accused of over the past couple months. Through the comment sections or through emails that I have received, which you guys haven't all seen or won't see. But I've been accused of some things, and I thought, you know, my thing as a public speaker and as a creator is I don't mind criticism, actually. I don't mind negative feedback. I think where I take an exception to criticism or negative feedback is when it's based on something that is inaccurate, is something I didn't actually say or didn't actually do. And if you follow my channel, and if you're part of the community on my channel, then you'll see me jump in on those comments from time to time to try to clarify what is it that the person actually disagrees with that they think I said or think I did. And you know, and I want people to disagree with me. I don't have a problem with that. I just want them to do it for the right reasons. And I don't mean to come off sounding like L. Ron Hubbard here, right? Because one of the things in Scientology is if you disagree with L. Ron Hubbard, then it must be that you just don't understand what he said, you know? And I don't, that's not what I'm actually saying. You can disagree with me. If we both think that, I don't know, if you think Hillary Clinton is a wonderful person who's full of integrity and honor, well, I don't agree with that. Right. And so we're going to disagree. And if you clearly state, you know, your position about Hillary and why you think that, I'm going to look at that and go, well, I don't agree because of X and Y and Z. And so I don't look at her as a truthful person. And pretty much like I look at, you know, all politicians, unfortunately. And so we're going to disagree. And that's fine. We'll agree to disagree. No problem. Right. Now, a commenter a couple weeks ago called Babalafish or Bablofish, I'm really not sure how to pronounce that, sorry. He wrote a lengthy dissertation in the comments section about why the progressive left is just flat out wrong in everything they do. And he made some good points and he made some bad points. And because I engaged with him and I value the feedback I get from all of you guys, I'm going to address some of what he brought up and talk about that, okay? He was highly critical of my perceived left-wing bias and my left-wing ideas and attitudes, and he is a Trump supporter. So without question, he and I do not agree on politics. We just don't. And I doubt that anything I'm going to say here today is going to change his mind about that. And I'm not going to sit here and talk about Trump. Okay, so just in case any of you guys are thinking that's what I'm going to get into, I'm not. Okay? And at least not too much. Okay, so, well, here's the thing, though. In these comments that he wrote, there were some good things and there were some bad things. Now, I am not above being wrong. And in fact, I don't even consider it a sign of weakness to admit that I'm wrong. And there's a lot of people out there who really seem to have a problem with saying they got something wrong. Really don't know what that's about. You know, I do it all the time. It doesn't hurt my feelings, doesn't hurt my ego to go, oh yeah, you know, okay. You know, because I get to learn new stuff. And I'm, you know, I'm not all about asserting how right I am and how wrong you are. That's really not what I'm about, okay? So first, let's talk about Black Lives Matter and discrimination in this country, in the USA. Now, as far as Black Lives Matter goes, it's a specific movement. It was started by three women and three black women, you know, and it's got a website, it's got an agenda, it's got specific ideas and things like that and things it's trying to accomplish. Some things they get right and some things they get wrong. But because in this country, we crave narratives, we want a story, man. And we're trained from birth, you know, because of the nature of our society and the way our civilization is set up, we really are raised from birth with the idea that there are, you know, there are only people who are heroes and there are people who are villains. And we think we have to choose sides. And we have to be all in or all out. You know, it's either Black Lives Matter is great and it's the best thing since sliced bread and it's fighting for everybody's rights and how dare you question it. And then, or on the other end, it's Black Lives Matter supports violence and wants to kill cops and it's all about racial disparity and it's all about causing divisiveness and how dare you support those people? They might as well have been founded by the Antichrist. And you get these disparate views. And uh, that's It's that way, not just with Black Lives Matter. It's that way with so many things. It's ingrained in our thinking, in Western culture. I don't know, maybe all over the world, but it's a point of critical thinking to realize that that's a bias we all have. I don't know what to call it—the good guy, bad guy bias. I don't know, but we do it. We naturally, and well, maybe not naturally, but we. It might as well be natural because we're raised with it, and this is how we look at things. So, Black Lives Matter was founded after the killing of Trayvon Martin in Florida, right? You all might remember a few years ago, you know, that he was killed by George Zimmerman. And, you know, I spent quite a bit of time looking over all the facts of that. It's been a couple of years. That case was investigated at a local, state, and federal level. There were lots of eyes on that case and what happened with it, okay? And when you look at that case, there were lots of inaccuracies and outright lies told during the time of its reporting. And you can't go back and change that. There is no reset button on history. And that's a shame because the entire incident was misrepresented in a number of ways. Specifically, what I'm talking about are the fact that the police investigated it and decided not to prosecute. Trayvon Martin's family decided that they wanted a lot of media about this because they were outraged and felt that George Zimmerman had acted incorrectly and had murdered their kid. Well, they hired a publicist. And, you know, within a day or two, this story became national headline media. You know, great. All the facts aren't in. It's not clear exactly precisely what happened. The police were still investigating it. Yet, in the court of public opinion, this case was tried and George Zimmerman was found guilty of murder in the court of public opinion almost immediately. And MSNBC and NBC and ABC decided that that was the narrative that they were going to run with. And George Zimmerman was made out to be an evil, horrible person. He was first portrayed as a white man when in fact he's Latino. Trayvon Martin was shown years old pictures of him. Were shown when he was younger. His skin was lightened to make him more sympathetic, whereas with George Zimmerman, the only thing they showed of him was his mugshot. And he looked overweight, and he looked like you look in a mugshot. You don't smile when you're in a mugshot. So I'm not saying right now anything about whether George Zimmerman did or didn't murder Trayvon Martin, because here's the thing. There was a very short period of time between his 911 call and the police showing up where the only people in the world who know what happened are Trayvon Martin and George Zimmerman. None of the rest of us actually know what happened, and we're never going to. So I'm not going to sit here and pontificate about whether George Zimmerman did or didn't murder Trayvon Martin. However, what I am going to pontificate about is how the case was reported on, because the bias against George Zimmerman was immediate and very, very direct, to the point where when the 911 calls, and there were two of them, when those calls were released to the media, NBC specifically, spliced those two calls into one and presented them in an edited version, making it look like, or sound like rather, that George Zimmerman was a racist. Well, the evidence shows that George Zimmerman is not a racist. You can say a lot of things about this guy, but a history of racism is not one of the things that you can claim, because it doesn't exist. And in fact, just the opposite exists. George Zimmerman's history and everybody who was talked to about him from his past indicated that he has, as a Latino member of his community, always been in support of the Black community and specific Black people in that community. He stood up for, in one case, when nobody else did. So there is not a racial motive evident in the facts surrounding this case. However, immediately this case was made about race. And that is media bias. And that's his family, and that's the media creating a narrative, which we all crave. We want that narrative. So everybody fell into believing that narrative. Okay. Then the case was not going to be tried, but because of all the public pressure on the case, George Zimmerman went to trial, and he was found innocent, or at least not guilty, of murder, based on all the evidence. Now, the jury was sequestered, and they did not know everything that was going on in the world, in the big wide world, and all the race statements and various things that were being claimed. They were sequestered from all that, and they listened to all the facts that were presented, and they went in and they came back with a verdict of not guilty. One of those jurors, in fact, the only black woman on that jury, was interviewed on the news. Her interview, the raw interview, was edited down, of course, but it was edited in such a way as to make her seem to say that George Zimmerman, that she felt as a juror that George Zimmerman got away with murder. And she never actually said any such thing. She never felt that way. That wasn't what was going on with that jury. And yet the media had that narrative, and they continued feeding that narrative even after the case was over to ruin George Zimmerman's life. Well, you can have an opinion about whether his life should or shouldn't be ruined based on all the facts, or you can have an opinion about George Zimmerman's life being ruined based on media hype and misrepresentation of what actually happened. The choice is up to you as to, you know, how you want to form your opinions. I think facts matter. And so after looking at, you know, all the facts that are available on the case that I could look at, seemed pretty clear to me that, one, it was not racially motivated. Two, it was made very purposefully to look like it was racially motivated. And so as a result of that, these three women who started Black Lives Matter hashtagged on Facebook, Black Lives Matter, you know, hey, this is just another case of, you know, the white guys or black oppression and this sort of thing, because, you know, that has certainly existed in history. And so this was just added up on the mark of another case. Trayvon Martin was another victim of black disparity here in the United States. Well, that's just not true. That's not actually what happened in that specific case. Okay, so Black Lives Matter was started. They got the idea, and they started going with it. So you could say that Black Lives Matter was founded on a lie. Now, I'm not actually going to say that, because I think that the earlier instances of racial disparity and black injustices in the case of black people were evident enough and have occurred enough times that there is outrage about it, and some of that outrage is certainly justifiable. And so I'm not going to say Black Lives Matter was founded on a lie, because I think that's what it was founded on, but it started right after the Trayvon Martin case, and that case was presented in the way it was presented in the media and to the American public, was presented as a misrepresentation of what really happened. So I guess you could call that a lie. All right. Now, there are two other cases that followed right after that within a very short period of time. One of them is Eric Garner, and the other one is John Crawford. Okay, Eric Garner was the 250-pound black man in New York who was taken down with a chokehold, and while laying on the ground saying he couldn't breathe, an ambulance was called, and the ambulance came and picked him up. And by an hour later, or within an hour of his arrest, he was dead. And the medical examiner, this was in New York City, and the New York medical examiner ruled that the case was his death was a homicide as a result of the chokehold. Homicide meaning that his death was the result of purposeful actions taken by someone. Not that homicide doesn't mean that the guy purposefully meant to kill him, but those actions were taken on Eric Garner on purpose, and they resulted in his death. All kinds of contention about this, yet that's what the medical examiner came back with. Okay, now, if you want to talk about whether Eric Garner should or shouldn't have been arrested, should or shouldn't have had police attention on him in the first place, Was that police attention motivated by the fact that he was a black man? Those are contentious issues. It's not on video. We're not exactly sure about the, whether the officer who instigated the chokehold did so because he was a black man. I don't know if any of us can really say with certainty if that's the case. But you can definitely say without question that he was put into a chokehold. It is abundantly clear on video that that is exactly what happened. It's also abundantly clear that he was saying he could not breathe 9 times. And it's abundantly clear that no one engaged in any CPR or gave him medical attention. They called an ambulance. When the ambulance came, the EMTs did not give him medical attention. They threw him in the back of the ambulance, and he was driven to a hospital where he was dead. I don't see how there is any way to look at that except to say that those officers and EMTs were criminally negligent. Once somebody is arrested, which is what happened to Eric Garner, he is under the authority of the police. And he died under their authority, under arrest. So he is their responsibility. So how is it that none of those officers or EMTs are facing criminal charges? Well, we don't know, because the grand jury investigation that was conducted in New York, which chose to not indict any of the personnel involved, is all confidential. It's all under wraps, and we're never, ever going to see the testimony or hear what they heard or see what they saw. What we have is the video of the incident and the results of the incident and the information, from the media and whatnot, and it's inarguable, really, that this man was taken down, not given medical attention, and died as a result. Oh, by the way, the chokehold is against New York City police policy. New York City police officers are not supposed to ever put somebody in a chokehold. So the officer who did that was violating the policy that he was trained on in taking down Eric Garner. Okay. So clearly, these officers and EMTs who were involved acted, you could say, poorly, badly, criminally. They were criminally negligent. Why do I say criminally negligent? Because Eric Garner died. Okay. I'd call that criminal negligence. It's criminal. A crime resulted. A man died. That is an example or instance of where the system did not come through for Eric Garner. Now, Eric Garner's family sued the city and won, and I believe they were awarded, I think it was $5.9 million. Okay. So they won civilly. They won a civil case, but no criminal case. That's not so good. That's not a notch in the favor of the anti-Black Lives Matter people. And so you don't really hear Eric Garner's case talked about too much. It's not cited as one of those examples of why Black Lives Matter shouldn't be, because that is an example of why Black Lives Matter should be. Okay. Another example, John Crawford III. This was the man who was in a Walmart in Ohio, and he picked up a BB gun in the sporting goods section of the store, and he walked around the store talking on a cell phone and ended up in the pet supply section of the Walmart. And a man named Ronald Ritchie, who was a white man, observed John walking around with this BB gun. It was not apparent to him that it was a BB gun. However, Ohio is an open carry state. So it's perfectly legal in Ohio to walk around anywhere with a gun. Rifle, handgun, AR-15, doesn't matter. It's okay. It should not be a cause for alarm. John Crawford is a black man. Ronald Ritchie is a white man, and he was alarmed. So he called 911. Now, and you can look at this. It's on YouTube. It's on the internet. All the facts, everything I'm talking about is all available as public knowledge. There is a video which matches up Ronald Ritchie's 911 call with the surveillance video, the security camera footage from the Walmart. It very clearly shows John Crawford standing idly by himself without anybody else around in the pet food section of the Walmart, waving the rifle around in his hand back and forth, mostly pointing it at the pet food section that he's standing in front of in this aisle, and talking on a cell phone. That's what he's doing. It's very clear in the video that that's what he's doing. Ronald Ritchie tells the 911 operator that this man is walking around in the store waving a gun and pointing it at people. He was not doing that. Shortly thereafter, during the time of the call, a woman and two children walk through the frame. They're maybe 50, 60 feet away from John Crawford, who's just ignoring them and talking on his phone. They're ignoring him. I don't know that they even saw him. It's not clear in the video that they even saw him or were aware of his presence, nor he them. But Ronald Ritchie tells the 911 operator that John Crawford just pointed that gun at those two children, which he never did. So within a minute or two, within a very short period of time, the police show up. And if you watch the video, you see them come into frame in another surveillance camera video section. So he's over here. The police come into frame over here. From the moment you see their feet coming into the frame, in other words, from the moment they come on the scene, to the moment that John Crawford is lying down shot, dead, 3 seconds. Supposedly in that time, they yelled out to him to drop his weapon and lay down on the ground. He did not comply, and so they killed him. Two police officers. And now he's dead, laying on the ground. 3 seconds. I don't think in anyone's book that 3 seconds is a decent amount of time to tell anyone anything and expect them to immediately comply and lay on the ground. It wasn't even clear in the video that he had barely registered what they had said. He just starts looking over in that direction. Again, he's still talking on his cell phone, idly waving this toy gun. Within 2 seconds, a second of that, he's on the ground. The police come rushing in, and he's dead. Ironically, the woman who walked through the frame with the two children had a heart attack and also died because she was so alarmed when she'd heard that there was this shooting and everybody was rushing out of the Walmart, and she had a heart attack and she died. So two people died because Ronald Ritchie was so alarmed that he had to lie to a 911 operator about the actions of John Crawford, who was not hurting anyone or doing anything violent or doing anything dangerous in the middle of a Walmart. Now, this is another case where grand jury, a special prosecutor was put on the case in Ohio. A grand jury was called and failed to indict the two police officers who came up on the scene and killed this man. They also failed to prosecute Ronald Ritchie for false testimony, which is a crime. He got away with basically orchestrating the senseless and completely unjustified killing of a man in the middle of the day for no reason whatsoever, except that Ronald Ritchie was unduly alarmed by somebody openly carrying a BB gun in an open carry state who happened to be a black man. So, racially motivated? It's not apparent in the 911 call that Ronald Ritchie is a racist. I'm not going to sit here and say that he was. However, this is a very clear-cut case of a black man being killed for no good reason by police who acted completely inappropriately. It's on video. This is not a questionable point. The police acted inappropriately, and they killed him. And they were not indicted. Ronald Ritchie was not indicted. And so we have another case of justifiable grievances on the part of the black community toward the killing of one of their own by the police in the United States. Okay, Those things happen. That happened. Babblofish says in his comment to me, the left wants martyrs and is willing to jump to conclusions to get them. Well, you're right. That happens. And you're also wrong. Yes, Black Lives Matter was founded on the basis of some very serious media manipulation. And there were lies told by blacks and whites to feed a narrative that was decided on early in the case before all the facts could be known. And that narrative was just fed throughout that Trayvon Martin case. Now, Babblefish goes on to say, now let me say that I am willing to stipulate that the police officers who shot Alton Sterling and Philando Castile, these more recent shootings, may have been racist, drunk, poorly trained, on drugs, neo-Nazis, whatever. The key word here is may. I don't know all of the facts and neither do you. We only know what has been shown to us. The officers may ultimately be found to be guilty, but it is also possible that there may be relevant facts that are mitigating. It is your rush to judgment that is so disturbing. At 11:35, you call these unwarranted, unjustified killings by police officers. In doing so, you are allowing yourself to be part of a larger problem. This is him talking to me. Remember that the rush to judgment in Ferguson and Baltimore led to riots, widespread destruction, and a dramatic increase in crime as the police became afraid to engage the criminals. That is, by the way, not a conclusion I support, that the police became afraid to engage the criminals. And there's more on that later. The lies that were used to supposedly improve the lot of black citizens actually made their lives far more dangerous and reduced their quality of life. This fits in with the progressives' ultimate agenda just fine. The recent assassination of five Dallas police officers is not a surprise, given the hatred that has been ginned up by the left toward the police. It is dismaying and disturbing to see you jumping on that bandwagon. As much as you say you respect the police, you are not against the police, etc. The overall tone of this video fits in with the Black Lives Matter agenda, which is inherently divisive, destructive, and now we see deadly. All right. Again, Babblefish, you're right and you're wrong. You criticize me for rushing to judgment, and you have a point there. And I've clearly seeded that that was a valid point. Yeah, the lies and the false representations and false conclusions that the media forwards definitely do are made in an effort to try to make racial discrimination an issue and make it forefront in the media. And those lies and distortions do ultimately harm the cause, okay? But not for the reasons you have laid out. And then, of course, you're saying not for the reasons I think. It's kind of circular. Not only do some of these distortions cause people to overreact violently, because they do, I grant you that, when the media distorts these stories, when they make them out to be something they're not, that does incite people to take action, like the killing of the five Dallas police officers, which they definitely should not be taking. There's never an excuse for that. But reversely, one of the other consequences of that is it gives people like you, Babblefish, reason to think that there's no problem at all and that the left is just making it all up. And then you excuse and dismiss the entire problem. So you're going to another extreme of, well, there's no problem at all because of these lies and distortions. No, that's not actually the case. The Black Lives Matter agenda, as you call it, is actually to talk about unequal or unequal race relations in the United States. To define the entire movement, to define any entire movement by its worst case members, well, do we define all Christians by the Westboro Baptists? I hope not, because that would be just as wrong. Do we say that Anita Sarkeesian speaks for all feminists? I sure as hell hope not, because that would be wrong. So it's cherry-picking your facts that to serve your agenda or your narrative, and it disturbs me that you don't see what you're doing. Okay. So in that sense, by denying that there is any problem with race relations in this country, you yourself are contributing to what you are accusing Black Lives Matter of doing, which is being inherently divisive, destructive, and reaching a deadly irrational conclusion. To say there's no problem at all is just as wrong as saying that all this violence and horribleness that Black Lives Matter is engaged in, or members of Black Lives Matter is engaged in, that's wrong. Well, so is this. The truth is in the middle. Okay. And if you think, by the way, that I'm attacking you right now, I'm not, okay? I'm trying to point out that there are multiple sides to a complex and very layered problem. And this problem does exist in the United States. It is not all just made up. It is not just people on the left inciting violence and divisiveness and hatred because they don't have anything better to do. That's not what's going on, okay? And I've given you two cases out of three that show that. Okay, so Babblefish goes on. He says here, at about 26:10 in our last podcast, you, me, say, the horrible truth right now, especially if you are a Black man or Black person, you are not necessarily assured of fair and equal treatment by the police. I said that. And he says, the fact is that you are correct, but not in the way you intended. Black citizens are now more at risk, are being murdered, robbed, intimidated at higher rates, precisely because the police are afraid to police, because of the efforts of the left to demonize the police every time they deal with the violence in the inner city. Would you want to live in Chicago or Baltimore? Why not? Black-on-black crime is rampant in our inner cities. You can't attack the police and expect them to put themselves at risk of being prosecuted every time they have to deal with a potentially violent offender. Okay, again, Babblefish, you're right and you're wrong. Yes, the majority of Black people are dying at the hands of Black people. According to the Department of Justice, out of 6.4 million violent victimizations from 2012 to 2013, in 62% of those cases, the race of the offender was Black. Okay, so you want to talk about Black-on-Black violence. Well, in 62% of the cases, that's what you have. Interestingly, in the case of whites, in 56% of those cases of whites being victimized violently, the race of the offender was white. Okay, over half. And with Hispanics, the majority of those who victimize Hispanics are other Hispanics at 38.6%. So the moral of the story is that you are more likely to be attacked or victimized by people of your own race, and if you're a Black person, the chances of that are greater than any other race. That's just statistical fact from the Department of Justice, which I'll go with. But, okay, no, your conclusion that police can't be expected to put themselves at risk of being prosecuted every time they have to deal with a violent offender is not actually accurate, and in fact is woefully off base. And let me tell you why. It's not actually, okay, if you start going and researching this stuff, it's not actually possible to say how many people police have killed over the past few years. There are not any verified, accurate counts. And that was quite surprising. It surprises a lot of people to find that out. Now, two media channels, The Guardian in Britain and The Washington Post, have been keeping track over the past 2 years of all police, anybody who dies, you know, because of the police. And I presume that that's based mainly on media reports, because I don't think they have police officers or police forces reporting to them. I don't think that's a very likely case or scenario. The FBI database is the official government accounting, but not all police forces are obligated to report their figures to the FBI. And apparently there are some pretty big discrepancies between what the FBI says and what The Guardian and The Post are finding over the last 2 years. Okay, so we know that we don't totally know, but we have some guesses, we have some estimations, not guesses, we have some estimations. What we know over the past 5 years is the figure is somewhere between 400 to about 990,000 people a year, okay, are killed by police. It's totally safe to say and assume that most of those deaths are justified. They're documented, they're reported on, many of them are on video. This is not, you know, the police have body cams and whatnot. Every time a police officer kills somebody, it is at least investigated. So it's pretty safe to say that most of those deaths are justified. However, we know that not all of them were. Okay, I gave you two examples earlier. Since 2005, Bowling Green University has done a study, and they found only 54 criminal cases against police officers filed for police-involved shootings. Okay, 54. Okay, and that's since 2005. So that's the last 10 and a half years. 54 criminal cases brought against police officers. Not indicted, not convicted, just brought against them, okay? Here's what they say. In half the criminal cases identified by the Post and researchers at Bowling Green, prosecutors cited forensics and autopsy reports that showed this very thing. Unarmed suspects who had been shot in the back. It's half the cases. In a third of the cases where officers faced charges, prosecutors introduced videos into evidence saying they showed the slain suspects had posed no threat at the moment they were killed. The videos were often shot from cameras mounted on the dashboards of patrol cars, standard equipment for most police departments. In nearly a quarter of the cases, an officer's colleagues turned on him, giving statements or testifying that the officer opened fire even though the suspect posed no danger at the time. And in 10 cases, or about a fifth of the time, prosecutors alleged that officers either planted or destroyed evidence in an attempt to exonerate themselves. A strong indication, prosecutors said, that the officers themselves recognized the shooting was unjustified. 54 cases of criminal prosecution out of something between 4 to 10,000 deaths over the last 10 and a half years. Okay? That's a 0.92% chance. It's not even a 1% chance. It's a 0.92% chance of just being prosecuted. And guess what? Out of those 54 cases, 21 of them were acquitted, and only 11 were convicted, and 19 are still pending. So, are police being over-prosecuted? Should police be in fear of going to jail for dealing with violent offenders? No, not even close. That's a completely unwarranted conclusion that police are running around in fear of doing their jobs. That conclusion has no basis in statistical fact at all. Okay, and so I'm basically writing it off. Now, I'm not even going to deal with Babblefish's claim that white privilege does not exist. Now, here's the thing about this. I'm bringing up another hot topic item, so hear me out. Hear me out on this. There are plenty of cases where people have used the term white privilege to divide, and there are many examples, and I think there are more examples, where people are trying to simply point out that racial disparity exists. Okay. So here's the thing. I fully agree that the term white privilege is so overused, so baited, it's such a loaded term that it has totally lost any usefulness that it might have once had. Instead, I think it would be more effective if we put this under or describe this in a less loaded term, okay? Let's call it racial disparity. And here's the thing, it exists for a lot more minorities than just blacks. You know, it's amazing to me that there's no Latino lives matter. Because when you look at the statistics, you know, there's a good case to be made. If the statistics show a good case to be made for black deaths, I'm really surprised that there's no case being made for Latino lives matter. I wonder if that has something to do with the fact that Latinos are immigrants and blacks aren't. and we just don't seem to like immigrants that much in this country. So I guess it would be a little hard to start a movement about Latino lives matter when immigrants don't matter. So here's the thing about racial disparity. Legally, you're right. Legally speaking, there is no racial disparity. We beat it. Okay, the civil rights movement did its job, and the laws were passed, the laws are on the books, and legally speaking, all people of whatever race, nationality, color, have equal rights under the law. Okay, so can we say that that's true and still recognize socially that it takes a while for the culture to catch up? Proof? Well, look at how long it took for segregation to become desegregated when civil rights were passed. It was not an overnight thing. It took decades. There were schools in the South that were built to be separate but equal, and they stayed separate for years, years following the passing of the law, saying that, there should be desegregation, that, we should not be separating blacks and whites. Well, they stayed separated for a long time. Okay, so that is culture, that's society catching up. That's a generational thing as far as I can tell. Again, this is areas where I'm not an expert. So I'm just talking, you know, of what I've seen. And what I've seen is that you can pass a law, but it takes a while. And if people are raised in a culture where racial disparity is the norm, where it's expected, where that's just the way of things, where that's what the Bible says to do. If they're raised that way, they don't care what the law says. They're going to integrate at the speed that their minds change, if they ever change, which is why it takes generations. It takes a new generation coming who wasn't raised in that culture, in that environment, with those values, to change a culture, to change a civilization. This, I really don't think I'm talking, that I'm babbling or talking Martian right now. This seems like pretty common sense stuff to me. So socially, we aren't there yet. We aren't at a place of equal footing at all times for all minorities with you know, white folks. And that's not a universal statement. We have a black president, we have black congressmen, we have black judges, we have black mayors, we have black CEOs, we have very, very successful black people in this country. So to say that there is no equality, to say that there is no movement, to say that that blacks have no sense of human rights or no dignity or no progress has been made, that's extremist nonsense. Of course there has been massive progress made. Massive progress. And that progress, unfortunately, is not as readily accepted or acknowledged as it should be. You want to talk about divisiveness? Well, that exists on both sides of the political camp. Okay, so socially, we're not there yet. And cases like Eric Garner or John Crawford exacerbate that issue. They bring it to the forefront. They show that blacks are not always going to get a fair shake. Now, there are definitely going to be cases where you're going to find the same thing with whites. And you're going to talk about the justice system. And you're going to start talking about socioeconomic situations, right? Like the poor white in the South or in Detroit. They don't get a fair shake either. Okay, so is it only blacks who aren't getting a fair shake in the justice system? Of course not. Of course not. That's not, you know, it's not all or nothing. It's a multi-layered, complex problem. So do I think there's a problem with racial disparity still in the United States as a social issue? Yeah, I do. Do I think this is the biggest problem in the United States? No, not even close. Which also now leads me to my next point, okay, which is the regressive left, the progressive left. Well, there's this term called the regressive left and social justice warriors. And I have, unfortunately, especially prior to the Reason Rally, when I started really upping my awareness of this, I was falling into some of the traps and some of the word games and some of the attitudes that are pushed by what we call the regressive left. Okay, you have a liberal-minded attitude about social issues. You can have a liberal-minded attitude about fiscal issues, fiscal policies, that sort of thing, redistribution of wealth, socialism, things like that. I don't really get behind a lot of that stuff fiscally. Socially, I tend to go in the liberal direction in that I am pro-abortion, pro-human rights, equal rights for everybody, and I've voiced that stuff on this podcast. However, there is a part of this left-wing folk who are totally off the rails, who have gone way beyond, who have gone into extremism, okay? And we call those guys the regressive left. And here's the thing, these are people who want to stifle free speech in the name of giving people equal rights. It is the most contradictory bunch of nonsense I've ever had anything to do with. And I wish I hadn't had anything to do with it, but unfortunately, because of my liberal leanings, I moved in that direction. And so often, I have been accused of being one of these folks. And I want to tell you straight up, I am not one of these folks, okay? When it comes to freedom of speech, freedom, I want people to be able to say whatever they want to say, whenever they want to say it, ever, no matter what it is. I don't care. We should have that right. In fact, we do have that right according to our Bill of Rights. But the regressive left don't want that. They claim that this is a small, you know, I don't know how small they are anymore. This is all, it's this infected colleges, and you can find YouTube videos of this stuff all over the place. We're talking about, you know, safe spaces and being offended by what you say, and therefore you shouldn't be saying it. And how dare you? That's hate speech. You know, you shouldn't be saying those things because that's just hate speech. You're a bigot. You're a racist. This sort of thing. How dare you say that feminism is not an issue? You should just go kill yourself, right? These kinds of things. I just go, really, really, like, come on, that's ridiculous. And those people are ridiculous. And unfortunately, what we are seeing here is, and it's taken years for it to happen. You take a good thing, equal rights, women's rights, for example, okay? It is unquestionable from a historical perspective that women have been denied basic human rights. Okay, 1910, they couldn't vote, that sort of thing. We have moved forward because of feminism, because of suffrage, because of women standing up and saying this is wrong, and getting men on their side, and making laws happen, and making things change, we have moved forward, and now women have equal rights. Under the law, that is the case, and socially, that is the case. That's my position, okay? Not a big feminist, especially now. I am pro-equal rights. I'm pro-human rights. What I'm really saying is that feminism has done its job, and yet you have people who co-opt this and start pushing their own ideas, and they do them for really weird motives. Money, well, maybe not so weird. Money, you get power, personal validation, and generally speaking, you can identify these social justice warriors by the fact that they talk a lot, and they're not really doing much of anything. They just talk, talk, talk. And by the fact that they don't want you talking. Okay, that's not me. So, when you take a real live issue like racial disparity and you co-opt it into this thing where I'm gonna have equal rights by taking away your rights, That's not how it works. And that's regressive. That's not progressive. That's regressive. And that's why these people are rightfully being labeled as the regressive left. So that has been a problem. At least it's been a problem for me. I felt it's been a problem. And I and I haven't wanted to be associated with those people. So I'm just saying out loud right now, that ain't me. Okay, and that's not the show. There's never, ever, ever the purpose of this. Now, Babblefish and I disagree because he lumps all progressives, all liberals are regressives, are social justice warriors. And he generalizes this entire group of people, and he calls them the left, and they have this agenda and this sort of thing. Well, I think that's a huge mistake in doing that. And I think that that ends up insulting and castigating a lot of good people who are actually in the real world doing good work. And to lump all of them together and say, you're this entire philosophy and this entire group of people who want, social equality and want things to be a more level playing field for people, for opportunity and that sort of thing, they're just wrong. They're all just off the rails. Well, I'm sorry, I don't agree. And I think it's a mistake to lump all of them, including me, into that group. Okay, so are the regressive left a huge problem? Well, they basically encompass the worst parts of social and racial justice issues, and they've given the real liberal folks on the left-wing platform a really, really, really bad name, to the point where Babblefish and lots of other people out there are identifying the entire left with these extremist nutcases. And so basically what I think is happening now is a reboot is going to be in order, okay? Some kind of like, they're just going to have to kind of start over again. And we're going to have to unlabel this stuff and the stuff that's going on college campuses with the safe spaces and shouting down other people. And this, like, the idea that this is rational discourse and this is the way to make your point and this is the way to make things happen. There are some kids out there who are being taught some really, really bad lessons in how life actually operates. And these college kids are going to find the real world is not anywhere near as forgiving as their college professors or their, regressive friends who aren't going to really be friends for so long after they get into the real world and find out how things really work. So I think that the left needs a bit of a reboot in the same way that I think the right wing needs a complete and utter reboot. I mean, the problems with the right are just as outrageous. And I'm not going on a roll right now about the right, so I'm just saying, generally speaking, I see that both of these groups have gone so far off their principles, conservative principles, liberal principles. You know, these are things. This has been for centuries these things have existed. And both sides have gone so far into demagoguery, in other words, appeals to emotion, and they can't even talk about them rationally anymore. And it's a bit of a land, it's just a minefield when you get into it. Which is why I'm backing out of it. I could take my whole channel, and there are people who do this, and I could do nothing but rag on social justice warriors like Anita Sarkeesian, Rebecca Watson, or Steve Shives, and I could just talk all day about what bad people they are, and I could make a really good case for what bad people they are. Or I could talk about the right-wing demagogues like Donald Trump, and the fact that I think he is the living, breathing epitome of everything that is wrong with the right, and sort of the culmination of everything that is wrong with the right today, and why the right wing needs a reboot too. But, you know, I don't want to do that. So instead, you know, this stuff is impervious to critical thinking. So why would I go there? This country has been inflamed by the media and by these other forces and other things going on to such a degree that we are more divided, it seems, media-wise, social media-wise, than ever before. I can't myself bring sense to that level of insanity, and I don't think I should, keep trying. Instead, what I want to do is I'm going to talk about other things. Instead of talking to you now about all the things I'm not going to do, let me tell you what's going on here. I want to talk about other things with an eye toward informing and entertaining and not paying attention to the politics or the religion of it. You know, I guess there's a reason we don't talk about these things during, in polite company. And that's what I want this show to be. And I don't want this show to be divisive. I don't want this show to be about reasons why you're wrong and you're wrong and you're right and I'm right and you're wrong and rah, 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 rah. That's not what I'm about, okay? And the good news is that there's no shortage of these things to talk about, right? There's tons of this stuff to go over. There's science, there's reason, there's rationality, and there's really, really interesting people out there who are doing fascinating work. There are really, really interesting topics to talk about with this, in these fields, in these areas, and that was always the purpose of this channel. So I think we went a bit off in our grand experiment to talk about news and talk about social issues, and so I want to bring it back on that original purpose. And that's what I intend to do with this show now. You're going to see more interviews. You're going to see more of me talking with other people with alternate points of view, differing ideas than mine or yours or whatever. And I'm going to, want that. I'm going to pursue those. I'm going to get those guys on here. And in fact, I've already got, the interview for next week all lined up. And I think you guys are going to be fascinated by it. We get into atheism and politics in the South. Should be interesting. There's certainly some fodder to talk about there without being contentious or divisive, which is kind of interesting if you think about it. How do you talk about those things? But I think you'll see. So that's where this thing is going. Now, I'm not trying to win popularity contests, but if I'm going to build a podcast and I'm going to educate and inform, then I need to not alienate all you folks. And that's never, ever been my intention. So I've very much appreciated everything you guys have done in terms of the support that you've shown to me and my channel and this podcast, and I want to build on that, and I want to build an audience that is more informed and more educated out there so that all of us can just make more rational and critical decisions. And those rational and critical decisions don't have to be the same decisions I would make. You know, that's not how I judge that, okay? But they, if we are moving in that direction, I think we're moving in a positive direction. So I want to hear from you guys. I want to hear your feedback. I want to hear also what you would like to hear about or know about out there, because I've got lots of ideas and lots of things I'll be pursuing. And in fact, also some Scientology-related stuff too, which we've kind of, avoided for some reason on this channel. And I think I'm going to get into some of that. Also, and I think you guys will be fascinated by some of that, okay? In fact, there's an interview I want to line up for, 2 or 3 weeks from now that's going to talk about some stuff with Scientology that no one's ever talked about before. So that should be some interesting stuff. But if you guys have things that you think would be good for this channel or good for this podcast, you let me know, okay? I'm not trying to just throw stuff at you. I'm trying to build a community here. And that means back and forth. So you give me your feedback, your comments, and good, bad, indifferent. I take it all to heart, as you can see. And I think we're going to make a good thing here with the Sensibly Speaking 2.0. So thank you very much for watching. I'll see you guys next week. Talk at you later.